Would like to call to order the June 20th Cabarrus County Board of Commissioners regular meeting. Welcome. It's good to have such a nice group with us tonight. At this time, we will have the presentation of the colors. We do not have anybody presenting the colors. Okay, we will have the Pledge of Allegiance. All rise, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We are very pleased to have with us tonight Pastor Anthony White from the Refuge for our invocation.
Good evening. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we thank you for this evening. Father, I bless this group of men and women that's assembled before me. Father, I thank you so much for the gifts and talents and the way they guide and govern what you've placed into their care. Father, we ask that tonight that they'd flow in unison by your Spirit. Father, we ask that you'd continue to watch over and guard and protect them. Father, I pray that each one will continue to have an organized system of thought as they continue to bring leadership to this county. And Father, we bless this time together. We commit it to you. Oh, Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your graciousness and your lovingness and your kindness over these proceedings tonight. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. We appreciate you being with us tonight. Next item is approval or correction of minutes. And of course, you have copies of those before you in your agenda. Do I hear a motion to approve the minutes as presented? Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next item is approval of the agenda, including the changes to the agenda, and we have added one item to that. We will have need of a closed session tonight for personnel and legal matters. So at this time, I would entertain a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. That takes us next to recognitions and presentations. And first, we have a Concord High School CTE recognition. And we're happy to have Alan Thompson here to talk with us about that.
It is an honor to be before you tonight as we recognize a very important program in our community, the Concord High School Career and Technical Education Program for Public Safety. Back a few months ago in April, the Concord High School Career and Technical Education Program sent teams to participate in crime scene investigation, emergency medical technician, and then the fire program up to Greensboro. I think 11 students is what were sent up to compete and represent Cabarrus County. They did an extremely good job representing the county well, and they brought home several awards because of their efforts. And what this program means to us from a public safety perspective is that it's exciting to see young people in a high school program already involved in discerning whether or not they want to be part of public safety. And they're committing themselves and they're very passionate about what it is they do, the education that they're receiving, and then taking this to a new level by not only learning it, but being willing to go and represent the county and competing through written exams, interviews, and through practical scenarios. So at this time, I would like to recognize first Bill Jamison, who is our lieutenant with Cabarrus County, who serves as a liaison to the program over at Concord High School. And I believe we have Phil Patterson, who heads, Phil, if you'd like to come up. Who heads the program for the law enforcement side, and Earl Motzinger, and then the chief of the fire program, are not able to be with us tonight. But what I'd like now, if any of the students are here, I see one that are here from the program, I'd like to present a certificate if you'll come forward.
Thank you.
And I believe you are Dylan, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Dylan Fritz, is that correct? We want to present this certificate for outstanding performance from Cabarrus County EMS in recognition of your skills performance for the public safety skills at the April 2016 Skills USA. So thank you for your commitment and your classmates for your commitment in learning the material and preparing for careers in public safety.
Thank you, sir.
Sarah Bales. Mm-hmm. Sarah Bales, we also would like, and you're in the crime scene program,
yes,
as well, a certificate for outstanding performance and recognition of Skills USA performance for public safety skills.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. And before you get all the way back to your seat, we have another one for you, and that's Mission Lifeline Gold Award.
Captain Justin Bryans will be presenting this tonight.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. On May 16th, 2016, Cabarrus EMS was awarded the Mission Lifeline Gold Award from the American Heart Association for 2015 calendar year. We're proud to report that this is our second consecutive year to receive this award. Providing quality patient care is for the citizens and visitors of Cabarrus County is our number one priority. Mission Lifeline is a collaboration with the American Heart Association that helps communities, EMS agencies, and hospitals save lives by closing the gaps that separate patients suffering from heart attacks from timely access and to appropriate treatments. By voluntarily participating in the Mission Lifeline program, we demonstrate our commitment to quality care for our citizens and visitors, and we are excited to be a part of improving outcomes for patients suffering a heart attack. The first criteria for the Gold Award includes ensuring that 75% of all patients over the age of 35 who have non-traumatic chest pain receive a 12-lead EKG. We're proud to report that we exceeded that goal and that 100% of our patients in that criteria received a 12-lead EKG. The second criteria for Gold Award includes ensuring that 75% of all heart attack patients receive a life-saving heart catheterization within 90 minutes of the first time we make contact with the patient. The goal is only achievable by streamlining training protocols, equipment, and scene times to ensure that these patients receive fast and competent care. This goal would not be possible without collaboration from CHS Northeast with their administration and their cardiac specialist as well. We're pleased to report that we exceeded the 75% target, and 97% of patients that we encountered meeting that criteria actually received a catheterization within 90 minutes. We wish to acknowledge our staff for their dedication to public safety and patient care, and I would like to thank the county administration as well as this board for supporting our efforts and making awards such as this possible. I'd like to read the award presented to us from the Heart Association. It says, American Heart Association proudly recognizes Cabarrus County EMS for the Mission Lifeline Gold Achievement Award. The American Heart Association recognizes this EMS provider organization for demonstrating continued success in using the Mission Lifeline program. Thank you for applying the most up-to-date evidence-based treatment guidelines to improve patient care and outcomes to the communities that you serve. If you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer those, but thank you for your time and sharing this award with you.
Great.
Thank
you.
That award does recognize a collaborative approach that includes our first responders, our telecommunicators, our hospitals, EMS, and then of course the leadership of the county to make this all possible. And so thank you, Justin, for sharing
thank
that.
Thank you.
Great, thank you. We appreciate the hard work. I don't think we can say it often enough, the quality of care that we have here in Cabarrus County. And if any of you have had an opportunity to attend the event at the hospital, the annual event where you have heart attack survivors and other survivors whose lives have been saved, and you get to hear from their families and what that has meant to them. We are truly, truly fortunate in Cabarrus County to have that quality of emergency care available to us. So thank you again for what you do. Next item on our agenda is recognition of Sergeant Charlene Coker on her retirement, and I think Brad Riley is here to make that presentation.
Yes, sir. It is my honor and pleasure to share with you and recognizing
30 years of service from Sergeant Charlene Coker. I've known her my entire career. She's not much older than that, but she's done a fantastic job, and I'm glad that she came back tonight for you to honor her, let her know how much she has meant to the citizens, and she'll never know the impact that she's had on the folks in law enforcement in Cabarrus County, especially our jail and our courthouse. Charlene is a Cabarrus County girl, raised here. Her parents, Joyce and Clarence Moose, are here. Very supportive, very close family, great law enforcement and emergency service supporters. But Charlene was, again, raised here in Cabarrus County, graduated from Central Cabarrus High School in 1982, decided to bring her talents to the county for sheriff's office responsibilities in 1988, where she started in the jail. Throughout her career, she has had a chance to go into different divisions and do different things. She served a small stint on patrol. She served a stint in civil division and a little bit longer stint in courthouse security, and then she found her way back to the jail as a supervisor. We couldn't ignore those talents, and she's done a fantastic job. And I want it to be noted that when we made the transition into the newer facility we're in now, there were a lot of transportation issues and a lot of coordination that went on with sending transporting inmates in and out and coordinating their schedules and getting them back and forth. And it really was a Chinese matrix that she handled pretty much on her own. She did a fantastic job. She just wanted that responsibility, and really did a great job in making sure that we were efficiently running people back and forth. So again, this is kind of a bittersweet day for us. We hate to see her go, but she deserves the rest and the time away. And she loves to hunt and fish. I'm sure that that'll take up a lot of her time, and hopefully we'll see her smiling face. She's still got 2 weeks left with us, so yeah. we'll get what we can out of her in those 2 weeks. But Charlene, it's been a great honor and working alongside of you and being a friend to you, and I know we'll continue that. And she's very, very loyal, dedicated to the county, so I know she'll stay around. But thank you so much for dedication.
Thank you.
And I think Ms. Diane's
on behalf of the commissioners and the citizens of Cabarrus County, we want to present this clock to you for your years of service, and thank you, and wish you much happiness in your retirement.
Thank you.
In the next 2 weeks, you have a change of heart. We can take the clock back and save it for the next retirement round. Okay. How about that?
All right.
I think the irony with the clock is it doesn't have an alarm on it.
Okay. Thank y'all. I appreciate it. I've enjoyed working for the Sheriff's Department. It's a good job. I mean, I've enjoyed every bit of it, every division I've been in. And I'm going to miss it, but it's just time for me to move on. And I thank y'all.
Well, thank you. We appreciate your service and wish you well in retirement.
Thank you.
Great.
Okay,
next item on our agenda is a proclamation for Park and Recreation Month. The U.S. House of Representatives and the National Recreation and Park Association have designated July as National Park and Recreation Month. At the May 19th meeting, the Active Living and Park Commission voted unanimously to recommend the designation of July as Park and Recreation Month for Cabarrus County. And we have a proclamation to that effect, which I will read at this time. Whereas Parks and Recreation and Senior Center programs are an integral part of all communities throughout this county, including throughout this country, including Cabarrus County, and whereas our parks, recreation, and senior centers are vitally important to establishing and maintaining the quality of life in our communities, ensuring the health of all citizens, and contributing to the economic and environmental well-being of a community and region. And whereas parks, recreation, and senior center programs build healthy, active communities that aid in the prevention of chronic disease, provide therapeutic recreation services for those who are mentally or physically disabled, and also improve the mental and emotional health of all citizens. And whereas parks, recreation, and senior center programs increase a community's economic prosperity through increased property value, expansion of the local tax base, increased tourism, the attraction and retention of businesses, and crime reduction, and whereas parks, recreation, and senior center areas are fundamental to the environmental well-being of our community, and whereas parks and natural recreation areas improve water quality, protect groundwater, prevent flooding, improve the quality of the air we breathe, provide vegetative buffers to development, and produce habitat for wildlife, and whereas our parks and natural recreation areas ensure the ecological beauty of our community and provide a place for children and adults to connect with nature and recreate outdoors, and whereas the U.S. House of Representatives has designated July as Parks and Recreation Month, and whereas Cabarrus County recognized the benefits derived from parks, recreation resources, and senior centers, now therefore be it resolved that the Cabarrus County Board of Commissioners do hereby proclaim July 2016 as Park and Recreation Month. And I would at this time entertain a motion to approve this proclamation.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move for approval.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next item is from DHS, and this is Vulnerable Adult and Elder Abuse Awareness Month proclamation. Each year, hundreds of thousands of adults over the age of 60 are abused, neglected, or financially exploited. Elder abuse, including neglect and exploitation, is experienced by 1 out of 10 people ages 60 and older who live at home. Elders who experience abuse, neglect, or self-neglect face a higher risk of premature death than elders who have not been mistreated. Of growing concern is financial elder abuse, which is often unreported. It is estimated that elders throughout the United States currently lose a minimum of $2.9 billion annually owing to elder financial abuse and exploitation. Elder abuse remains an invisible problem because it often goes unreported. Research suggests that only 1 in 14 cases of elder abuse ever comes to the attention of authorities. Anyone who suspects that a vulnerable or older adult is in need of protection is required by North Carolina General Statute GS-108A-102 to report this information to the Department of Human Services. We all have a responsibility to support the safety, welfare, and dignity of Cabarrus County's vulnerable and older adults. We want to recognize May 8th through June 19th, 2016 as Vulnerable Adult and Elder Abuse Awareness Month and urge citizens to work together to help protect adults from abuse, neglect, and exploitation. And we have a proclamation to that effect. Whereas Cabarrus County joins the world in recognizing World Elder Abuse Awareness Day every June 15th, and whereas protecting Cabarrus County's vulnerable and older adults is a community responsibility, and all citizens are charged under state law to report suspected abuse, neglect, or exploitation to their local county Department of Human Services, and whereas Cabarrus County's vulnerable and older adults of all social, economic, racial, and ethnic backgrounds may be targets of abuse, neglect, or exploitation, which can occur in families, long-term care settings, and communities. And whereas in state fiscal year 2015, there were 24,545 reports of abuse, neglect, or exploitation of vulnerable and older adults made to North Carolina's 100 county departments of human services, an increase of 60% since 2008. And whereas national and international research show that abuse, neglect, and exploitation of vulnerable and older adults are grossly underreported, and whereas the Division of Aging and Adult Services partners with county departments of human services and other agencies at the county and state level to offer statewide programs for adult protective services and increase awareness about elder abuse and consumer fraud, and whereas the state of North Carolina enacted the nation's first elder abuse law and recognizes the need for a comprehensive system of protection for vulnerable and older adults, and whereas Mother's and Father's Days are national holidays intended to honor, respect, and promote the dignity and well-being of our parents, now therefore be it resolved that the Cabarrus County Board of Commissioners do hereby proclaim May 8th through June 19th, 2016, as Vulnerable and Elder Abuse Awareness Month in Cabarrus County, and commend its observance to all citizens. And I would entertain a motion to approve this proclamation at this time.
So moved.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next item on our agenda are informal public comments. I've got four cards. And we will, I think some of these folks, you have the opportunity to speak now or to speak during the public hearing for our budget. So I'll give you that choice. And first is Patrick Bergeron. And did you want to speak now or for the at the budget? Okay, great. Kevin Kirk. Okay. Bishop Roland Jordan.
You're ready to speak now.
Okay. We're ready.
Mr. Chairman, the board, and all the citizens, come for you tonight. I brought this to your attention before. I need some feedback on it, whether you approve it or not. The gay rights for the gay people. They my people, they God people. And he tell me to love everyone, and that's my job. So I'm trying to help them. And I ask y'all to let me know something soon, you know. And I talked to one of your employees talking about a raise. I hope you're getting more than whatever you're getting for a raise, but I think economics is getting better. And you want to keep your employees, you know, just give them a raise, you know. And as our youth, again, I need a feedback on that because it's very important. You're not going to mess with my kids getting them federal in court and stuff. If I had to go to the White House or wherever I'm going, I'm going. Because God don't like no one tapping with their kids. But anyway, I ask y'all to be in prayer for Ms. Wilma Means. She's trying to run for senator. We do need a black in office. We need a black on y'all board. So I hope them dishes get right where we can get somebody to help us and serve us. I know you got the Mexican here, but the Bible say we was here first. And I ask y'all, the black people, thanks for y'all support. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Representative Margaret Houston from the Friends of the Midland Library. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Commissioners of Cabarrus County, good evening. I would like to take a moment as a member of the Friends of the Midland Branch Library to thank you for your commitment to fund the operations of our library as mentioned in 2013. Your support is appreciated as the Friends continue to raise money for the interior furnishings, which has now totaled a little over $10,000. And to date, this year, we have 50 members. So we also want to thank in advance Emory Ortiz for implementing a temporary solution to service the Southern community with the library, including the upgrading of their software until our town hall is built. This will fulfill the need of the library in our community. This is in addition, I'd like to thank Doug Paris for working with Michael Downs to help make the library a part of our town. Thank you again. Good evening. Great.
Thank you. Okay, next item on our agenda is the approval of the consent agenda, which you all have in front of you, and all items that we have discussed at our work session. So I would entertain a motion at this time to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next item is new business, and first is the adoption of the fiscal year 17 Cabarrus County budget, and we do have a public hearing on that budget. So I will, at this time, call the public hearing to order and invite anyone who wishes to speak to the microphone. And so the hearing is in order, and I think the first card is Patrick Bergeron.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. I'm the president of the board of Northeast Fire Department, and back at our work session, we presented a request. I would like to revise that request tonight. We would still request a 2-cent tax increase to purchase a tanker. The cost of a tanker is much cheaper than a pumper. We'll be able to maintain our current staffing level. With this purchase, we'll be able to secure a loan ourselves and provide the funding for it with the 2-cent increase. This will count towards our ISO work, lowering our ISO for our district. The tanker will count actually as a tanker, a dedicated tanker, instead of using the engine for a tanker. We'll get full credit that way. And also it will assist us in our district because our district is water restricted, and a tanker would help out tremendously with that. So that's our revised request. Thank
Great.
You.
Thank you very much. Okay, the next card I have is from Kevin Kirk.
Hey, thank you. I'm Kevin Kirk, Chief of Northeast Fire Department. I just want to reiterate what Pat Bergeron was talking about. You know, with the revision of our budget request, we want to purchase a tanker, 2,000-gallon tanker. We do not currently have one, so we would like to be able to purchase a tanker where we can fund that ourselves. It will help us tremendously on our ISO. We'll be able to lower that rating to my goal, which would be a 6. We're currently a 9S, so we'd like to lower that to a 6, which would actually help community members to save money on their homeowners insurance. As again, you know, he said we'll be able to decrease our increase our staffing, keep our staffing, as our previous request. You know, we were going to cut out 2 nights, but we're going to keep that. You know, with ISO, water supply is 40% of the points. So, you know, with us being able to deliver, you know, more water to the scene on incidents, that will actually help us out more for that. So with that request, we'll be able to. And also, you know, $275,000 is what we're looking at to spend on a tanker. So that was, you know, tremendously less than $430 for an engine. So hopefully we'll be able to purchase that. Originally, we applied for a grant for an engine or for a tanker. So that was kind of hopefully best case scenario, get an engine and a tanker. But we did not receive that grant. So we're kind of, that's why we're revising our initial request. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Okay, at this time, I would invite anybody else that would like to speak on the budget to the podium. Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. And at this time, we move on to approval of the budget. And so we can either entertain a motion or entertain discussion.
Well, I'll make a motion to adopt the Cabarrus County Budget Ordinance for the General Fund, Cabarrus Arena and Event Center Fund, Landfill Fund, 911 Emergency Telephone Fund, Health and Dental Insurance Fund, and Workers' Compensation and Liability Insurance Fund for FY17.
Okay, do I hear a second to that motion?
I'll second the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and the floor is now open for discussion. Well, I will start that off. Certainly for the benefit of those persons visiting or watching at home, this has been a lengthy process that staff began working on this budget many months ago, and it's been presented to us some time ago, and on Monday, May the 16th, actually. Since that time, we have had numerous discussions, both in our public meetings as well as two special budget sessions that we held also, all of which have been televised and open to the public. So it has been a good process, one that I think we've discussed a great many parts of the budget. We've made a few adjustments, which all of you have in front of you, and maybe, but there were several things that were suggested that we were able to add for our school system, including some extra funds to provide for counselors during the summer months to help with some of the scheduling that Commissioner Poole suggested. I think also we were able to add some mental health professionals to the school budget to help some of that student population that is very much in need of that assistance. So, you know, I feel very, very good about the process that we have very thoroughly discussed a great deal of information. So I thank all of you, fellow commissioners, for being so engaged in that process. Are there any other comments?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a couple of comments myself. I was just sitting here thinking, you know, while we're looking at this $233 million budget, and this is the 14th budget of this magnitude that I've been able to be a part of over the years, and I have to honestly admit that this was probably the most easiest. They're never easy, but if there is such a thing as being easier, this was easier than all of the other ones that I've had to be a part of. And that I dedicate that to Pam and to Susan and to Kristen and that the finance department there and, you know, everyone that had a part in this and the various departments, because when it comes to spending taxpayers' money, we have to be diligent. We have to do our due diligence as commissioners and try to find what we feel like is best for the people that we represent. And I'm just so thankful for our county manager, Mike, for your leadership and for all that you do, you know, to see to it that the public funds are protected and used for the well-being of our citizens. And I'm just real thankful for the way that this budget went out. And so that's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you. Any other discussion? Hearing none, at this time I would entertain all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. And that motion passes unanimously. And now we will discuss the fire tax items, which if I get to the right place here. And of course, we have had a great deal of discussion about that as well. And we've heard several public speakers tonight regarding the request. And so at this time, I would entertain a motion. We've had requests for changes on three of the tax rates. And we have those here, if I can find them. But we've had a request for an increase in the Midland Fire Tax District of how many cents? Mike, do you?
Two cents.
And then Odell Fire Department has also requested two cent as well, and then Northeast Fire Department had requested
two cent
originally, different, yeah, and changed to two. So those three have requested a change. So do I hear a motion on the fire tax rates?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to adopt the Cabarrus County budget ordinance for the fire tax district code fund for fiscal year 17 and set these tax rates for these fire districts. And all of these do reflect the 2015-16 tax rate with the exception of Midland and Odell with the increase that they did request. The Northeast request at this time was not included in the motion to approve. But the Allen Fire District will be set at 0.550, which was the same. All these are the same except for Midland and Odell. Coldwater, 0.600. Concord Rural, 0.410. Flow Store, 0.500. Georgeville, 0.920. Gold Hill, 0.800. Harrisburg Rural, 1.315. Jackson Park, 0.580. Kannapolis Rural, 0.350. Midland, 0.800. Mount Mitchell, 0.826. Mount Pleasant Rural, 1.030. Northeast, 1.070. Odell, 0.680. Richfield Meisenheimer, 0.700. Reimer, 0.680. And that's the motion for approval for these particular tax district rates.
Okay. Do I hear a second to that motion? I'll second that motion. And now we will open the floor for discussion. Yes, ma'am.
I just want some clarification on the Northeast. When we talked about it before, they weren't talking about a tanker. Is that correct?
I think originally they were talking about a
pumper
truck.
And if I heard what they were saying here was that the tanker would allow them to have more water at the sites of the fire, which in turn would affect the rating for the insurance for the people who are served. Is that correct? But we don't know how much it would affect them, whether that would be a wash, where it would be tax instead of insurance. If that's the situation, I have no problem with it.
It depends on what rate they're able to lower the insurance ISO rating. Like the chief said, their goal is to get down to a 6. It varies based on the structure, but the citizen would more likely see a lower premium that would be far offset from the increase. I'm not sure what on $100,000 what the 2 cent is, but I mean it's probably less than $20-$30 to where on the insurance they could see a reduction of $300 to $400 a year versus that $30 increase.
And the other question I had was, here's where my age and my memory may be bothering me. Was it your department that had the issue of the days that it would not be staffed? Was that your department? We had one of them that said something about that.
The original request included the engine, and they were requesting that the county upfront the money or offer a zero interest loan in order to service the loan on the truck. They were going to have to reduce staffing on 2 days a week. Their proposal here is to buy a less expensive truck that in a sense would create or do the same, have the same impact on the insurance rates, getting the water to the site. They would not have to lower their staffing as proposed. think I got that all right, correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
Okay. That answers my questions.
Okay.
Speaking on the ISO rate, Mr. Chairman, I don't know a lot about that, but I know that those guys that work for that, everybody, all fire districts, that is their goal, to get to a six or lower. And I think some of our fire departments probably are at six or close. And I believe that Northeast has been nine for a very long time. And one of the reasons that it's so large, and you guys are here, you can correct me if I'm wrong, one of the reasons that that ISO rate, which determines what homeowners pay for their insurance, is the distance they are from a fire department, is that's one of the larger areas, one of the larger districts of all of the fire districts in Cabarrus County. They cover a vast area, and they don't have adequate water like some of the others do. And so, I mean, I don't know what it would take, you know, to get that ISO rating down, but I don't think you can do that in 1 or 2 years. I think it's a year-to-year-to-year process. And one of the reasons that, you know, that some of you may know that I was opposed to increasing the Northeast Fire Department tax, one of the main reasons was because you came before the board last year and you were asking for a 6 cent increase. And the county and the fire people recommended that we give you 3. And then here, when we came at this same meeting last year, I think I was the one that made the motion that we increase it to 4, which would have give you 4 cent of the 6 cent that you were requesting. And I personally can't see going back to the community and giving them a 2 cent additional fire tax, you know, so that you might have an influence on your ISO rating. If I felt like that it would have a definite positive effect on the ISO rating, then, you know, I would be a little bit more for it than I am at this point. But I think all fire departments have the same goal, to get the ISO rating, because it does save the taxpayer money on their homeowner insurance. And it's quite a bit more than what the little tax increase would be. And I fully understand that, but I just wanted to explain that best I could. And if you want to add to that, you can, but I think that's pretty well right.
Yeah, Pam just let me know it was like $19.46 for a 2 cent increase that someone would pay on a $100,000 home. In order to lower the rating below a 9, the large portion of that grading is water. It's about how much water can be provided and how fast it can be moved. So, you know, definitely a tanker with a larger capacity will benefit and help the department in being able to lower the rating. You know, they can't do it without the water.
Do you have any idea of how much the water portion? I think somebody said it was 40% of the ISO was the water availability. Do you know how that compares with the distance to what Commissioner Shue was talking about, the distance from the station?
Yeah, it would affect anything that's within 5 miles of the station. So, you know, some of the departments have a split rating currently because they have hydrants. Currently, the only departments in the county that have lowered the ISO rating where there's no water below a 9 is the Odell Fire Department and Harrisburg through their grading 2 years ago. So, you know, like you said, it is 40% when it comes to moving water, and then the rest of it's various things that they're graded on, from training to their apparatus and equipment and checks, prevention, 911 plays into their grading as well.
And how long would it take for the ISO rating to go down if they got this tanker now? Would it be a year, 2 years?
Well, if they started right now, really meeting some of the requirements through the ISO for pre-planning, their training records and things of that nature. Right now, the state is on a year. If you request it now, you're looking at about a year out. So, you know, they could potentially have their rating lowered within a year and a half.
And what's that likely? I mean, is there a trend as to what that might go to, from 9 to what, because of a tanker?
Well, Gold Hill, actually, I misspoke. Gold Hill lowered their rating, which is one of their neighboring departments, and they were able to lower theirs to a 6. and they are kind of in a similar boat as Northeast. They don't have hydrants within their district, similar departments, similar size equipment. So, I mean, I think they would be able to achieve lowering, you know, to a six.
And if for some reason they did get the tanker and the fire department would disband for some reason, what happens with that?
Well, really, the department has its board of directors, and it's a nonprofit organization, so it really falls back to that board as to what they do with their equipment at that point. Right now, through the contracts, we do have where, you know, the departments would try to offer any equipment to surrounding departments that they're close to, or any department that would take over service of that district.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions?
I do. So, yes, ma'am. Do you recommend this or not? I mean, this is different from the original one, so I understand the original request was not being recommended, but is this 2 cents for this tanker recommended or not recommended?
I would recommend for the tanker, yes. You can't, they're not going to be able to lower the rating without the additional water.
How are they currently transporting the water? I know there are designated spots to pick up water. And
yeah, I asked Pat to come up and maybe discuss some of their water points that they may already have in place. But, you know, currently they have the state through the ISO, the minimum requirements for a nine is that they have a tanker and an engine. But what they have is just 1,000 gallons for each of those. So a true tanker is definitely more than 1,000 gallons is what they're proposing.
Right. And mainly in our district, it's all rural. It's all farmland. A penny is $11,000 to our budget. And basically, we get our water now from ponds and what we call dry hydrants. It's a six-inch PVC tube goes down to water. We hook a truck to it and draft the water out of a pond. We're in the process of trying to hook on the water line that just came through with Concord and everything. We're still working on that. But the needed flow that we're going to need for a lot of our chicken houses, hog houses, our big buildings requires 3,500 gallons for the ISO. So if we take one of our pumpers and dictate it as a tanker, we don't get full credit. So we're losing a pumper on that side of the ISO. So we're fighting against ourselves. We don't have a choice. So with a dedicated tanker, that's going to get us where we need to be.
Yeah. And so now you're doing that job with your pumper.
Yes, sir.
Truck.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Very good. Any other questions?
And I mean, I do understand. I take it very serious, Mr. Shue, about the taxes. I mean, I do. Tracy will tell you, our Secretary of Treasury, I do not like spending money. But when it's a needed, it's needed. We don't have a choice, because if we don't progress, we're going backwards, you know? And that's the thing in government, anybody's organization, if you're not progressing, you're going backwards. And that's what we're trying to do. We've got a lot of young people involved, and, you know, we're making progress. So I don't think we're going to go under, Ms. Honeycutt.
I just didn't know how that worked.
I understand, but with Steve's help and Bobby's and everybody else, we're there. We just need to get over that hill, and we're at the crest. We've got to get over the hill, though. Okay.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, any other questions or discussion? If not, we have a motion before us, which provides for maintaining the current tax rate for all the fire districts, with the exception of Midland, which is getting a 2 cent increase, and Odell, which is getting a 2 cent increase. And that does maintain the Northeast rate at the current rate. So if there's
Mr.
no...
Mr. Chairman,
yes, ma'am.
Make a motion to amend the motion to include the 2 cents for Northeast to be used for the purchase of the tanker as they have requested and as staff is recommending.
Interrupt for a second. The 2 cents, not it's not quite right for Odell and Midland. The 2 cent was for Northeast, but the, let me get my computer here. My screen's frozen here, sorry. Hold on a second.
It's 1.6 for Midland.
Yeah, 1.6 for Midland, and then one penny for Odell.
1.6 for Midland and
.01. Yes, one penny for Odell. The tax rates that were called out by Mr. Shewar was absolutely correct.
Those
but
were correct.
The increase, right. We wanted to point that out, that it was not a 2 cent across the board for those three.
Okay.
It's 1.6 for the Midland and 1 cent for the Odell.
Great, thank you.
The request was 2 cents for Northeast.
Very good. Thank you for that clarification. Okay, we do have a motion on the floor to amend the original motion. Is there a, yes, sir?
I just advised Commissioner Poole that technically you can't make a motion to amend a motion that actually has the opposite effect of the original motion. So it either needs to be voted on the way it's been originally stated, unless there's an amendment that just modifies it in some way that doesn't change the exact effect of it to something the opposite, or it just needs to be voted on straight up.
Very, very good. Thank you. And I think that request for an amendment does negate the original intent of that motion. So we will vote on that
motion. At least as to the Northeast Fire District.
Yeah, yeah, which was the only change. So any other discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no.
No.
Okay, that motion fails. And now the floor is open for another motion.
Go ahead. I don't have the numbers in front of me.
I would like to make a motion that we approve the fire tax rates with Midland at 1.6, Odell at 1, and Northeast at 2.
A second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second, and I think it's safe to assume that all the other figures in the previous motion are included as to the current tax rates. Is there, yes, sir, did you have a comment, Rich?
No, I was going to respond to a question to the clerk.
Okay, thank you. Sorry. Okay, any discussion? Okay, hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no.
No.
Okay, that motion passes 4-1. Okay. Next item on our agenda is approval of project ordinances and budget amendments related to CIP-funded projects in the fiscal year general fund budget, and Ms. Dubois is going to talk with us about that.
If you turn to page 362 in your agenda, we went over these during our budget work sessions, and I tried to summarize this because there's a lot of paperwork to keep all the accounting straight. There were 4 project ordinance, 5 budget revisions, but this is a summary sheet of all the projects we discussed. There is $6.184 million for school construction projects, Kannapolis Intermediate renovations, CBTC 2 projects for Rowan Cabarrus Community College, and school land banking. We have the projects for the Cabarrus County, which equaled $5.5 million, and there's a detailed listing there. One of the projects is in the small projects funds. It's the prime farmland, and that is just a change moving monies within 2 different areas of the same department. And then the funding resources for all these projects are the capital reserve fund, the general fund, and the deferred tax collections. So all the ordinances and budget revisions make all this happen. So if this is still the will of the board, this is what you had discussed in the budget workshops and when all the information was gone over. So if this is what you still would like to do, that entire agenda item will make this happen in the appropriate funds and transfer the monies back and forth.
Okay. Very good. Questions for Mr. Bois? Okay, I would entertain a motion to approve project ordinances and budgets amendments related to CIP-funded projects in the general fund budget.
So moved.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? And once again, for those watching, that's a very complicated list of things that we have discussed at length during our work session. So all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next item is fiscal year 2017 Economic Development Allocation. And this item does call for a public hearing, and we'll hear from Ms. Farrington first.
At the agenda work session, we briefly spoke about the need for a public hearing. Each time we have a new economic incentive agreement, which I think we have on the board meeting tonight, you have a funding plan. So that is part of the appropriation that we will take into consideration when we're committing our fund balance at the end of the year. But as far as the actual EDC contribution, the Economic Development Corporation's contribution that we annually make and as part of our budget, which you just passed, we have to have a public hearing for that appropriation. So tonight's hearing is for the $400,000 that we annually appropriate to our Economic Development Corporation. So, questions?
Great. Thank you very much.
I knew that we have not done in the past, but we will continue to do that each year after tonight.
Right, and I think that is a result of a new general statute that
Absolutely.
Requires for a separate public hearing.
Yes, thank you.
So we're not changing what we're doing, just the way we're doing it. And so at this time, I would open the public hearing for the discussion of the fiscal year 17 economic development allocation. And invite anybody to the podium that would like to speak in regards to that allocation. And seeing none, I will close the public hearing and entertain a motion to approve the allocate. Well, let's see, do we need a motion on this? We do not need a motion on this. We just have the public hearing. Okay. Next item on our agenda is economic development grant request for Project Blue. That will also involve a public hearing, and we will hear from Samantha Grass prior to that.
Thank you all. Thank you for the opportunity to present the project information to you this evening. Yokohama Corporation of North America, Project Blue, is considering leasing 21,400 square feet of space at 4715 Corporate Drive, located in the International Business Park in Concord. Yokohama is seeking to establish a new technical development center. The center will be primarily focused on tire and material development, indoor testing, research, tire benchmarking, with focus on unique requirements of the North American marketplace. They are projecting an investment in personal and real property of $5.8 to $7.5 million. The real property would consist of the upfit of a lab for specialized equipment and testing, and all the upfits would be specific to their operations. They plan to create 56 full-time positions associated with the project. This number does include 15 current employees that would be relocated to this facility. The 41 other positions would be all new hires. Please note that their average wage is over $80,000 annually, which is well above our county average wage. This project is very competitive, and a location decision has not been announced yet, but we hope to hear their decision later this month. Their decision is contingent on the approval of City of Concord grants and also state approval as well. Their investment exceeds the minimum requirements of the economic development grant. The Cabarrus County investment analysis is based on the estimated $5.8 million to $7.5 million projected company investment. Due to the nature of this project and the average wages presented, we are asking for your consideration of a five-year term, 85% economic development investment. And the projected grant range for that five-year term is $174,558 to $225,133. And I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Great. Thank you. Any questions for Ms. Grass? Okay, thank you very
thank
much.
You.
At this time, I will open the public hearing for discussion of the Project Blue or Yokohama Tire Grant and invite anybody to the podium that would like to speak in regards to this matter. Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and entertain a motion in regards to this request.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion that we approve the economic development grant 5 years, 85% between Project Blue and Cabarrus County, and to authorize the county manager to execute the agreement on behalf of the board, subject to review or revision by the county attorney.
Okay, do I hear a second to that motion, to that motion? Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? This is a very exciting project for Cabarrus County. I had an opportunity to meet with some of the representatives from that company. I think more, of course, those are some pretty impressive wages, averaging $80,000 per year. I think that the biggest part of this is the fact that there is a great possibility of future expansion here in Cabarrus County. So it's an exciting project that I think will serve us well. Any other discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. And that motion passes. Thank you. Okay, next item is design changes for the STEAM magnet program at Royal Oaks Elementary. And we're happy to have Tim Louder with us.
Cutting it close here, Jonathan. Didn't think I was going to show up. Thank you. How are y'all doing this evening? I'm here tonight to talk to you about the, as you know, the Cabarrus County is looking into a magnet program for throughout the school, trying to redistribute our students in a volunteer way rather than a redistricting way, if you will. And one of those is we have an opportunity right now with the new Royal Oaks going in place. At the location it is, we are building it for about 250 kids more than the present population when they move back in, coming up in the next, in mid-year January of 2019, or January 2020, I guess. And 19, I'm sorry, it's 19. In doing so, one of the programs we wish to create there is a arts magnet, something we do not have at the elementary school level. And at this point in time, we can do some modifications to the design, which is a normal elementary school, to allow some edges for some of the theater areas, for some music areas, some additional acoustical treatments. We're taking a multi-purpose room and relocating it into the maker space inside the media center, a few things like that in order to accommodate an arts program. And in order to do so, those design changes are necessary for the architect to make some design changes for the contractor to be able to make those modifications as we begin to come out of the ground. And so what we're asking for is additional fees for the architect to do that design network for us. It's $21,600.
Okay, and am I correct that all of those funds are already in the budget? This is just a...
We have some allowances in the budget to allow us to hopefully make all the modifications once the construction portion of the contract comes.
Okay. Other questions for Mr. Louder?
Hold on. The money's not in the budget. This is new money.
This 21-6 is new money, yes.
21-6 is new money.
Okay.
The design money's new, but the construction contract has the... They need design money from their contingency.
From the contingency.
The contract can take care of the rest of it.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I thought that's what you asked.
Right. Okay. Great. Glad we got that clear. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you. So I would entertain a motion on this matter also.
Chairman, I make a motion that we approve the request.
Okay, do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next item is from Sheriff's Office, Memorandum of Agreement with Rowan County, allowing use of Backup 911 Center. And I think Ray Gillian is here to tell us about that.
Mr. Chairman, I can go ahead and do it. This is a memorandum of understanding that you approved at an earlier time. However, as the process of getting approved here and then at Rowan County requested to add one sentence, and that was to get through their audit, their pre-audit process up there. Their finance director kicked it back out simply because it was sort of an open-ended mm-hmm. deal. So if you'll look on page 3 of the actual document there, you can see actually handwritten in there by the Rowan County manager. It was where it is referring to that Rowan that will pay Cabarrus for the use of the facility during a disaster situation, and also planned and unplanned services, and then training. exercises as well, and it sort of left it open-ended as to what they would pay the county, and their manager is requesting to add the additional statement there, the daily fee shall not exceed $500 a day. And that is the only change. However, it was a change. That's why we brought it back to you, so that we could get it approved.
Okay. Questions?
That amount logical? Are you acceptable to that amount?
Yes, ma'am.
And so how would you have determined the amount if that wasn't in there?
We would have had to have a conversation and discussed it with them. So same thing here. We'll still have a conversation up to that 500, yeah, depending on how long they're using it and what they're using it for. So.
Okay.
But this gives them a finite number or a ceiling that won't go over, so that their finance person feels comfortable with that.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. I would entertain a motion in regards to this matter.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we approve with the included change that has been explained.
Okay. Do I hear a second? Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. And that motion passes. And that takes us to appointments to boards and committees. And we have a full list of those tonight. First one is the Adult Care Home Community Advisory Committee. An application to serve on the Adult Home Care Community Advisory Committee has been received from Ann Holland. She has been pre-qualified by the Regional Ombudsman and is eligible to be appointed for an initial one-year term. So at this time, I would entertain a motion to appoint Ann Holland to the Adult Care Home Community Advisory Committee for an initial one-year term ending June 30th, 2017.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion, a second, and a third. And any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next is the Board of Equalization and Review. Mary Elizabeth Stewart, Chairman, and Audie Dover, Vice Chairman, serve on the Board of Equalization and Review and have terms expiring June 30th, 2016. Both have indicated they are willing to be reappointed. Both Ms. Stewart and Mr. Dover have served on this board since 2005. An exception to the length of service provision of the appointment policy will be needed for them. So at this time, I would entertain a motion to reappoint Mary Elizabeth Stewart and Audie Dover to positions on the Board of Equalization and Review with terms expiring June 30th, 2019, including exceptions to the length of service provision of the appointment policy.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next, we have appointments to the Cabarrus County Planning and Zoning Commission. An application to serve on the Cabarrus County's Planning and Zoning Commission has been received from Jeffrey Corley. Mr. Corley resides in the central planning area and is eligible to fill the position vacated by Andrew Deal in February. I think we had discussed that during our February meeting. So at this time, I would entertain a motion to appoint Jeffrey Corley to the Cabarrus County Planning and Zoning Commission to complete an unexpired term ending August 31st, 2016, and appointment to an additional three-year term ending August 31st, 2019.
So moved.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next, we have appointments to the Cabarrus County Tourism Authority. Vinay Patel, Pratesh Najari, Troy Taylor, and Tammy Whaley serve on the Cabarrus County Tourism Authority and have terms ending June 30th, 2016. They are all willing to serve an additional term. The Cabarrus County Tourism Authority has submitted the following nominating groups and nominees as follow. Cabarrus County Board of Commissioners, seat number 7, Vinay Patel. Cabarrus County Tourism Authority, seat number 8, Pritesh Nagari. Cabarrus County Tourism Authority, seat number 12, Troy Taylor. Cabarrus Regional Chamber of Commerce, seat number 9, Tammy Whaley. Mr. Patel, Mr. Najari, and Mr. Taylor represent integral parts of the Cabarrus County tourism industry, but as Mecklenburg residents, they would require an exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy. Recommendation letters have been attached to your agenda for the Tourism Authority and Chamber nominees. So at this time, I would entertain a motion to reappoint Vinay Patel, seat number 7, to the Cabarrus County Tourism Authority for a 3-year term ending June 30th, 2019, including an exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy.
So moved.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. Next, I would entertain a motion to reappoint Pritesh Nagarji, seat number 8, to the Cabarrus County Tourism Authority for a 3-year term ending June 30th, 2019, including an exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. At this time, would entertain a motion to reappoint Troy Taylor, seat number 12, to the Cabarrus County Tourism Authority for a 3-year term ending June 30th, 2019, including an exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy.
So moved.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. And would entertain a motion to reappoint Tammy Whaley, seat number 9, to the Cabarrus County Tourism Authority for a 3-year term ending June 30th, 2019.
Approval. Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. And next we have appointments to the Centralina Workforce Development Board. The terms of appointment for Milton Chickas, private sector representative, and Tracy Brunt, private sector representative on the Centralina Workforce Development Board, ends June 30th, 2016. Both are willing to serve another, and a recommendation letter is attached. An exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy will be needed for both of them, as well as an exception to the length of service provision for Mr. Chickas. At this time, I would entertain a motion to appoint Milton Chickas and Tracy Brunt to the Centralina Workforce Development Board for 2-year terms ending June 30th, 2018, including exceptions to the provisions of the appointment policy as needed.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. And next we have appointments to the Juvenile Crime Prevention Council. Juvenile Crime Prevention Council terms of appointment for Megan Bumgarner, District Attorney Designee, and David Zinka at large, and Michelle Wilson at large, end June 30th, 2016. All are willing to serve another term. The JCPC voted at their April 20th, 2016 meeting to recommend them for reappointment. An exception to the length of service and multiple service provisions of the appointment policy will be needed for Ms. Bumgarner. So at this time, I would entertain a motion to reappoint Megan Bumgarner, David Zinka, and Michelle Wilson. Well, first of all, we've got to do the one separately. A motion to appoint Megan Bumgarner to the JCPC as the district attorney designee representative for a two-year term ending June 30th, 2018, including an exception to the length of service and multiple service provisions of the appointment policy.
I'll move for approval.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. And then now would entertain a motion to reappoint David Zinka and Michelle Wilson, both at-large representatives, to the JCPC for two-year terms ending June 30th, 2018.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. The county appoints three seats, extraterritorial jurisdiction, to the Mount Pleasant Planning Board and Board of Adjustment. All three seats have terms expiring on June 30th, 2016. Mr. Murdoch, Mr. Moose are willing to serve another term, but would require an exception to the appointment policy. Ms. Strickland vacated her seat, and an application has been received from Mr. Burleson, who is willing to serve in her place. And I apologize, I don't have all those. Now, John, that's John Murdoch III, William Whitaker Moose Jr., and Margaret Strickland. At this time, I would entertain a motion to reappoint John Murdoch III and William Whitaker Moose Jr. as regular appointees to the Mount Pleasant Planning Board and Board of Adjustment for a three-year term ending June 30th, 2019, including exceptions to the length of service provision of the appointment policy.
I'll move for approval.
Okay, we have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Mr. Chairman, before you vote, aren't these for extraterritorial positions? Mr. Burleson lives in the town limits. He lives on Franklin Street, right there at the square, I believe. I guess what I'm saying is that we might want to hold on that one until next month. Go ahead and approve
and
the other two.
And double check the residency appointment on that one.
The one that would fill the vacated. The one that was going to, he was going to be an alternate.
Rick Burleson.
Yes, sir.
Right.
We didn't vote on the first one yet.
Yeah. Okay, so. But the first motion was for Mr. Murdoch and Mr. Moose and did not.
Correct.
Yeah. So we have a motion and a second. Yes. Any further discussion on that one? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. And on advice of the county manager, we will hold the third appointment until next month and check on the residency situation. And next we have Phyllis Wingett and Steve Morris. I know him. Serve on the Public Health Authority of Cabarrus County and have terms ending June 30th, 2016. Ms. Wingett is willing to serve another term and a recommendation letter is attached. If reappointed, Ms. Wingate will require an exception to the length of service provision of the appointment policy. So at this time, I would entertain a motion to reappoint Phyllis Wingate and Steve Morris to the Public Health Authority of Cabarrus County for three-year terms ending June 30th, 2019, including any exceptions to the provisions of the appointment policy.
Amen.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes. And just one more. Okay, and this will be appointments and removals from the Transportation Advisory Board. Lee Glass, Cabarrus Health Alliance, Healthy Cabarrus, Judy Coble from the Life Center, Michael Smith from Cabarrus EMS, and Andy Yost, County Safety Manager, currently have served on the Transportation Advisory Board and have terms expiring June 30th, 2016. Lee Glass, Judy Coble, and Michael Smith are willing to serve another term. An exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy will be needed for Ms. Coble and Mr. Smith. Andy Yost is no longer employed by the county and resigned from his position on the board. An application has been received from Lauren McCray. She is the safety officer for Cabarrus County and is recommended to fill the vacant county safety manager position. Ms. McCray is a Mecklenburg County resident, so an exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy will be needed for her. Kathy Kitts, Midland area term on the Transportation Advisory Board, expired last year. She has not been able to attend the Transportation Advisory Board meetings. It is requested to remove her name from the roster. So at this time, I would entertain a motion to reappoint Lee Glass, Judy Coble, and Michael Smith to the Transportation Advisory Committee for three-year terms ending June 30th, 2019, including an exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy.
So moved.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye. All opposed, no. That motion passes. And would entertain a motion to appoint Lauren McCray to the Transportation Advisory Board as the County Safety Manager Representative for a three-year term ending June 30th, 2019, including an exception to the residency provision of the appointment policy.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye. All opposed, no. That motion passes and would entertain a motion to remove Kathy Kitts and Andy Yost from the Transportation Advisory Board roster and thank them for their service. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. And that motion passes. And we now move to reports, and you have a number of reports attached to your agenda. And also at this time, we'll receive updates from commission members who serve on various boards, committees, and liaison positions.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to, as a liaison for Harrisburg, remind residents that the Harrisburg town will be having their July 4th festival June 30th through July 2nd. They'll have, I think, fireworks two nights, the parade, bands, Miss 4th of July pageant, and much more. So I'm sure they would love for people to come out and support that festival.
Great. Thank you. Does anybody else have reports? Yes, ma'am, Ms. Minot.
This is not an official county department, but the Cabarrus County Education Foundation is having a special night with the Intimidators on Saturday. And it's Star Wars night. They're auctioning off a Star Wars shirt, and they're going to have all kinds of other activities for families. and it's an excellent thing in the summertime for you to bring your children and support the Education Foundation at the same time.
Great. Thank you very much. Okay. Are there other reports? I will mention one thing. This kind of falls in between our general comments or updates, but in the June 10th edition of the Business Journal, Cabarrus County was awarded the 13th healthiest employer in the region, which is a pretty big honor. And I think in looking over all the other winners, I think that Cabarrus County is the only, certainly is the only government in that top tier that has been recognized. And I think our own Pam Dubois was named the healthiest employee last year for the entire region, two years in a row. So that is quite a big honor that I think our staff and employees need to be applauded for. So congratulations. They do a lot of things to shine a positive light on Cabarrus County all the time, and we certainly appreciate it. Are there any other general comments by board members? I will remind everyone that we do have on our website a listing of various boards and committees that are in needs of members, and you heard we had a lot of those to approve tonight, so I would encourage people that are interested in getting involved and participating in activities in the county and the boards that govern us, that you please fill out an application. If you don't see that information on the website, you can call the county clerk, Megan Smith, in the county manager's office, and she'll be glad to direct you to that information as well. We do have need of a closed session tonight, so I would entertain a motion to go into closed session to discuss matters related to personnel and legal issues authorized by North Carolina General Statute 143-318.11A6.
So moved.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion passes, and we are adjourned to closed session. Thank you.